Welcome to the Holding All the Cards podcast. My name's Daniel. I go by kiamode on the forums. And today I'm going to talk about variance. Now, in most card games, the community, they view the term variance as kind of like a bad word because variance is kind of code for inconsistency, right? So like if your deck has a higher variance, it really just means your deck doesn't win as much as other decks could win. So I want to talk about why variance is actually a pretty good thing in our game and how you can use it to your advantage. So in our game, you have good pods, bad pods, mediocre pods, etc. So like there's some pods that are always good, right? So there's some pods that are game-winning pods that have game-winning cards. Every card's good. They're what I call perfect pods. By my count, there's about five, right? You have Yoda's pod, Falcon's pod, Tarkin. Maybe not so much after the nerfs, but he's still really good. Vader, the new one, and Palpatine. Every other pod has some sort of flaw in it. Those pods are all good. I mean, those are the kind of pods that if you could conceivably play 10 of them in a deck, you would just play 10 of them and then the game would die. Luckily, we don't have that many. I mean, I personally think that there should be zero perfect pods. Like if a pod ever becomes perfect, it should either become banned or nerfed. But that's neither here nor there. The point being that the cards that are always good are meta-defining. They're the cards that completely shape how the game is played. On the other hand, you have terrible cards. So there's some cards that are always bad. Like Decoy Dantooine's never going to be a great pod. And neither is Rumors of the Cantina. You know, like those are pods that at best, if you base everything around the pod, you can make them mediocre, but they're never going to be great. You know, they're never going to be pods that you love. And that's just an unfortunate reality of the pod system, that if the one pod really gets messed up, it's dead forever. But I mean, that's not any different from any other card game where 80% of the card pool is just not played because it's not tier one. So every other card, though, outside of like the great cards and the crappy cards, they fall somewhere in the middle. Right, and how good they are is usually dependent on how powerful their upside of ability is and how consistent you can get them. But even within pods that are considered better, there's some pods that inherently have more high variance cards and some pods that have low variance cards. So I think on Dark Side, the perfect example is like the Mara Jade versus Saris debate. And I think where you stand on that debate, because they're both about even in terms of power level, where you stand on those two pods is largely dependent on your playstyle and really your experience with Saris. So let's look at both pods. Mara Jade's pod is always going to be a B plus pod every single game, right? You know what you're getting with it. You get a resource, that's always good. Protector, generally good. You get a lightsaber, which is kind of a whatever card, but I mean it still gives a guy a gun. You get Mara, who offensively is targeted strike plus shields, offensive targeted strike plus two blasts, defensively is just shields. She's a force holder, she's elite, right? So you know what you're getting out of her. And then Rage is one of those cards that's really easily telegraphed. You're never catching anyone by surprise with the Rage. And really you kind of have to build towards a Rage in order to make it work well. It's oftentimes a win more card, right? It's oftentimes a card that it's like, okay, I've managed to hold force through your turn and I have big bodies and I have Palpatine, so now I'm gonna like strike, rage, blow up the objective, Palpatine brings back a rage, strike with a different dude, rage again, bring rage back, and you know, just do like a kind of mini duel to end the game. But I mean, as good as that is, you need to be in a position to be able to play it, and on top of that, you ain't surprising anybody by it. But it's good, right? Like Mara's a good pod that a lot of people like, but you can only get so far from it. Like Mara's never gonna take a lost game and turn it into a won game, right? Like you're never gonna be in a situation where like, crap, I'm losing, there's no way for me to win, maybe this protector gets me out of the way. Like that's never gonna happen. But now let's look at Saris. So I'll go over the downsides of Saris first. The first being, sometimes you draw into a hand. Like say, either you mulligan into a hand or you just drew a fresh hand. And your hand contains Saris, some Chud, and four other cards, right? Fate cards, resources, whatever. And so you're faced with a decision where it's like, okay, I can either play Saris and nothing else, or play a Chud and nothing else. And Saris is demonstrably better than any 2-drop, but she's also substantially worse than just about any other 4-drop. So if all you're doing is playing Saris and passing, you might just lose the game right there. There's a very good chance that just doing that by itself means you lose. And a perfect example of this would be when I was at Worlds, I played against Ryan Coach, and he had and this was during Swiss, and his turn one with his deck was Saris plus Resource. Now going forward, he actually had pretty good cards. He had like a turn two Vader. I think he got Palpatine on the table. He was able to get some TK strikes. I think he drew into some lightnings. Like, it's not like he didn't draw cards. The problem was he just played a turn one Saris. And the reality is, if you're up against me with any deck I take seriously on light side, and I don't have catastrophically bad draws, if your turn one is Saris pass, you lose. Like, there's just no way you're going to win. And that's what happened to him. Like, Saris, she's, like, as a unit, she's just atrocious. So she can lose you a game in that sense. Then you look at something like what's it called, Deadly Sight. It's a 3-mana card, so you never want to be using it to take out a 2-drop. Like, if you're in a position where you feel like using it on a Guardian or on a Slicer or a Children of the Force or something like that, like if you feel like using it on that's like a good justifiable way to use your resources, that's probably bad. And then on top of that, like, sometimes you'll hold on to the card thinking your opponent's going to play something that's worth using the card on, and then they only play 4-drops, and so now you're holding on to a Seeds that, or not a Seeds, a Deadly Sight that doesn't do anything, so you just float at 2 mana, and so it doesn't work. And then Seeds, the card in there, sometimes your opponent just doesn't have committed units, and so that sucks. And then sometimes you desperately need a blocker. Like, there's times in games where you're just thinking, okay, give me any unit, right? Like, you're just praying for your deck to give you anything just so you could throw bodies in front of attackers. And then you draw the Chud in Saris' set, who doesn't have a black gun and only has 1 health. So these are all cards that can very well lose you a game, right? They're cards that they show up at the wrong time. They're dead cards. They don't do anything for you. But now let's look at the good side. So on the bright side, the resource is always good. There's never a bad time to draw that resource. Then you look at something like Deadly Sight. Deadly Sight, while a lot of the times it's bad, while a lot of the times it's just a dead card, every now and again you'll kill a Landspeeder with it. You'll kill a Independence with it. You'll kill a Kraken with it. Like, when you get those kinds of turns where it is functionally like a Force Lightning, that's when that card goes from dead card to one of the best cards in the game. That's when you think of what a high variance card is. Deadly Sight is a perfect example of a high variance card. Sometimes it's really good, sometimes not so good. And then something like Saris. So I explained, if you get Saris early game and you're forced to play her, you kind of want to cry yourself to sleep. But sometimes you're mid game and you kind of already have your board set up, and what you need is just unique Sith units who are big, because she's a 4-drop. So if you use TK Strike, I'd rather use TK Strike on Saris to tap down Luke than use it on Palpatine or Vader or Mara or someone that's actually relevant for board presence, right? So if she can be my my TK Strike fodder, now she's actually not bad. Like, now I kind of want to play her. And then similarly, sometimes you just need anyone to trigger a Visage. You know, like, you just need to throw someone in front of something to trigger a Visage. And then also, her 2 health is now not as much of a liability with Visage itself, because generally I think of black tactics on low health units as effectively white tactics, because if Luke attacks and Saris defends, if Saris loses edge, she's gonna die. So then she effectively doesn't have a tactics. Like, you only get that black tactics if you win edge. But with, you know, something like Visage, now it does something, right? Now she's not totally worthless if you throw her in front of something and can't win an edge battle. So in those situations, it's actually a pretty good card. And then also her Chud, if you need to play defense, he's atrocious. But sometimes you want to play offense. Sometimes you want to get some attacks off. And, like, let's say your opponent has a speeder bike who has no force icons. Now that guy's awesome because now you can send that guy in, send in your big dudes, say the speeder bike can't block, and then you can targeted strike, get him off the table, or do whatever else you wanted to do. And that's just the variance, right? So like Ceres, she can actually turn lost games into won games, but also she can lose you games too in a way where Mara, she's not going to win you games that you would have lost, but she's not going to lose you games that you should have won. And that's the main difference between the two. And so I think how you look at them is generally based on your experience, right? If the Ceres cards always seem to hit at the right time, Ceres is going to look great. If they always seem to show up at the wrong time, you never want to play her. But that's a pretty classic example of like two pods, roughly even power level, but the variance is just a little different on them, right? Like, I wouldn't say that Mara's objectively better than Ceres, but I will say she's a little more consistent, but Ceres has higher upside. Now, there is something, like the reason I wanted to make this video is that there's a deck that I played against in the online tournament. And I was really impressed by it because it's a deck that every pod has high variance cards. So the deck was played by Med Freeman, and it goes two of the Endor home one, two of Yoda's, two of Capital Cover, two of Pilot Luke, the good one, and two of the new Wedge. And then he also had an 11th pod, which he put one copy of Independence, but I've played it without the 11th pod. Like, I took out Independence, and the deck still works really well. So here's the high variance cards, right? Starting off with Home 1. So Home 1, Solidarity of Spirit is one of the most interesting objective cards in the game for me, because that's one of the cards that I see people misplay more than really, like more than most cards, because I'll see this all the time. So I'll play against somebody, they'll show Rebel Affiliation, and turn one they go home one, right? Like, so they have home one for the objective, and then their turn two, it's like they play a two drop or a three drop and then pass. And at that point it's like, and they didn't mulligan, and the reason that they did this was because like they look at the objective and they think, oh my gosh, I gotta have a good unit for this, I have home one, I can't give this up. But they don't think about the follow-up turn, because the objective of Solidarity of Spirit, it's a two-part effect, right? So part one of the effect is, can you win the trade? So whatever card I choose to play from Solidarity of Spirit, is it better than the card you can play? So if you're split color, you might not be able to play anything. And even if you're in faction, maybe you just didn't have like the greatest hand, maybe like you're playing Navy and your main unit's Chimera, but I played a three or four drop, so now you have to play like Mythyl or something. Like, in those situations, that's where you would look and say, okay, well, can I win that trade? But then the second part of that is, okay, regardless of whether I won the trade or lost the trade, can I have a better follow-up turn than you can have? And this is where I think a lot of people mess up. A lot of people just don't even consider the follow-up turn. They just simply consider that first turn. So they'll keep hands they shouldn't keep. And I think if you're playing that pod, you should be thinking, okay, this one card is going to be the card I'm going to play with Solidarity of Spirit. With these other five cards, would these other five cards I have here be a playable hand? And if the answer is no, then you need to mulligan that hand. But you don't see that. Like you rarely see that with when people play Solidarity of Spirit, because they're just so locked into, I have Independence, or I have home one, and I have Solidarity of Spirit, I have to play it, right? Like I have to keep this hand regardless. And that's where they mess up. But then similarly, I've seen it on the other end where I've played Solidarity of Spirit, and it's like, okay, I play red five, right? And my opponent counters with Tarkin. So they won that trade in that sense, because you'd probably rather have Tarkin than red five. So you say, okay, well, you win the trade, the first trade. But then if your follow-up turn as a Navy player is, okay, so they got the Tarkin on the table, and then what they play from their hand is like Stormtroopers or Mythyl or Yularen or a Gladiator, right? If you're if you're not even using your full resource base, you're just paying 3 mana or less, you have now only produced 6 resources worth of crap on your table. Then let's go to my turn. So I've played red 5. I now have minimum 4 resources that I can use. So if I'm able to max out my resources, like maybe I play one of home one's chuds and then follow it up with a 2-drop ship, or maybe I play a 4-cost Luke, maybe I play home one's resource and then drop a home one, right? Like if I can find a way to maximize my mana, but you don't maximize your mana, now I have won the complete trade. And I've seen that happen as well. Or sometimes you'll even get lucky and you'll go home one for Chimera. So I think you would say the Navy player wins because Chimera is better than home one. But then Navy player has their deployment, they'll play resource and then no units because they only had like a one, like, because sometimes you'll usually keep that. Like if you're playing Navy and your hand is resource plus Chimera plus edge cards, you're probably going to keep that almost every time. So if you don't have a follow-up unit, like any follow-up unit whatsoever, then I win the trade because I have home one plus 4 resources worth of crap and you only have just the one. So that's an example of the type of card that can blow games open. Then you throw in, you have Yoda. Yoda has all sorts of degenerate crap that can win games. You have Luke, which has I Have You Now. I Have You Now is kind of a hard card to trigger at the right time, but when you get it to go off, it can very well win games. Then the new Wedge, I haven't been loving the units in the new Wedge pod, but I do really like his objective. Like his objective, when it hits right, is just devastating. Like when you push Palpatine out of combat, when you push Chimera out of combat, when you push Caesar out of combat, it completely changes the game. And then also just the threat that you could push someone out of combat, now your opponent has to block with 2 guys because they could say, okay, I can win edge, but I need to throw both of my guys at this problem because one of them might get pushed out and then they can just strike at will. So that's like another good way to potentially blow games open. And then lastly, you have Capital Cover, which as good as like the Protect is and the Concentrated Firepower is, I think the objective is really where it's at, because the only real counter to that objective is direct damage. So like Force Loyalty or Emperor's Promise or something. Like in those situations, you can deal with the objective relatively easily, but it becomes a real problem when it's like, okay, I play Capital Ship turn 1, I'm going to swing, and that Capital Ship has shielding. So now it's harder to deal with. But then to make matters worse, I use May the Force Be With You, pull tokens off the Capital Ship. Now if you want to attack into me, not only do you have to deal with the Capital Ship, you have to deal with the fact that I can place a shield on top of the objective, so one damage doesn't hack it. You know, you have to actually deal 2 damage, and because capital ships have high health, you can't bank on unopposed, so you're gonna have to do 2 full damage, and a lot of factions can't pump out that kind of damage that early if they're actually opposed, if you actually have edge cards and you're making it a little bit tougher on them. So I like what that objective can do if left unchecked. And again, sometimes you'll just get Enforced Loyalty and it gets turned off. Sometimes you won't have the opportunity to use an I Have You Now at the right time. Sometimes you'll lose a trade on Solidarity of Spirit and then you push on the follow-up turn to Solidarity of Spirit. And sometimes you don't flop May the Force Be With You, so Yoda's cards just become edge cards. Like, it's not like all these things are necessarily going to hit every game, but some of them can hit, and when one of them hits, that's when it changes the game. And then also, like, there's consistency too, right? It's not like it's all just high variance, like you either get lucky or you don't. Sometimes you can just have normal games. Like sometimes you can go turn 1 Yoda commit, turn 2 play the little tactics guy plus one of home one's guys, and you start building up a board. And then you wait for the right moment, you play R2-D2 on one of the ships to give him shielding. Shielding guy goes in, you concentrate a firepower, and you know, you can play like a normal game of Star Wars. Like you're not locked into this like I need to get the perfect combo to win type of thing. Like you can just play Star Wars, but you can also get the combo to win. And that's the benefit of having high variance things. And I don't think you need to necessarily build your decks with the intention of high variance cards. Right, I don't think high variance cards need to be the only thing that you think about when you play, but I do think it's something that should be taken into consideration. So I'll give two quick examples. So when I went to Worlds, both of my decks that I ran, both Lightside and Darkside, have built-in high variance cards that sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. So in my, my whole Lightside deck, I think you could say is high variance cards. Like it's a tricolor deck, it's a combo deck, so there's a lot of ways that you can potentially get lucky with it, but it still has enough consistency to work. My dark side deck, where I went with the high variance cards, was I went with one copy of Ceres, which admittedly was the weak spot of my deck, but there were a couple games where that pod came through. And then I put in a copy of Arden Lynn. And Arden Lynn, I'll get to that in a sec. And then I also won one copy of Inquisitor, because the Inquisitor, most of the time his pod just isn't doing that great. He's really good. And the rest of his pod, you just have to pray it works. But sometimes, you know, you play the enhancement on some guy, and then you wait until their turn, their conflict phase starts, they attack, and you're like, I force choke the guy to put a token on him. It happens, right? It's rare that it works, but when it does work, it's actually pretty cool. And then also card draw is good. So I'll talk about Arden Lynn first, because this, I think, is the key example for when variance is a good thing. So Arden Lynn, her purpose for being in my dark side deck was I just wanted ways to get nudges out of the way. I had the two force chokes from Palpatine, but I want Vader's objective to hit as many relevant units as possible. And to do that, I need nudges out of the way. So I figured if I put Give Into Your Anger in the deck, now I have a way to get rid of nudges. Arden Lynn herself is like, she's kind of crappy. The Chud's kind of crappy, and the enhancement's trash. But the objective's good. Like, the objective can definitely win you a game. So normally it's just for the events to kill nudges, and the objective is there to mess with my opponent's draws. But every now and again, and this is why I really wanted to play it, every now and again you'll be in a situation where you need to get lucky. And this is relevant when you're playing a player who's either as good or better than you are, and their deck is as good or better than yours is, and they're drawing better than you're drawing. You're gonna have to get lucky. You can't win every game. You're not gonna outdraw everyone every game, and sometimes you're gonna be with your back against the wall. So in the Top Cut losers bracket, I was up against former champion Tom Malucci, and dude's just drawing well. You know, like, sometimes you can just feel it. Like, you can feel that somebody is just gonna draw the nuts in the game. So, like, his turn one, he goes Yoda plus the Force resource from, from Moldy Crow. He had a great objective flop. His turn two, he goes Luke plus lightsaber, swings in, does what Luke does. And his turn three, he's able to rip off a combo where he goes like nothing for deploy, swings in, he pitches Q-Ron and Edge, uses unfinished business to bring him back, lets me strike so I can deal two damage to Luke, so he gets protected to Q-Ron, so he shoots the two damage back, force rejuve with Luke to get an extra strike off, he can still recur the lightsaber. Like, he had the capabilities to actually win turn three. Now, as we know, I actually happened to win that game, but the way I won that game was I had to get lucky. So first turn, you know, I think I played like Tarkin and like Inquisitor's Chud, and I use Arden Lynn's objective on him. And then that's when he hits like the Yoda plus resource, and you can just kind of smell it, right? So what I started doing is I won Force on his turn. I actually kept the Force the whole game because I was able to keep blanking May the Force be with you, and I always was able to play enough big units to maintain Force. So what I did is every turn after that first turn, I just started using Arden Lynn's objective on myself, because what I had is I had a Give Into Your Anger in my opening hand. So I just started using it on myself over and over and over again. And he's just stream of one and two pip cards. And I was just thinking like, man, I desperately need to have a 3, 4, or 5 pip card on the top of my deck, because if this guy rips off the combo I'm afraid he's going to rip off, I'm going to lose this game really fast. So I keep burning through cards, and I don't get anything. And then he has a turn, right? He has turn three. He is going to win the game. And so I have Inquisitor out, and I just used Arnon Lynn's objective again on my previous turn. And I looked at the top two cards. One of them was a crap card. The other one was a TK strike. And so he goes in, does his turn. And he had the option to have Luke's lightsaber be attached to him early to kill the Inquisitor before I could do anything. He chose not to kill the Inquisitor. He chose to let the Inquisitor strike because he did the unfinished business trick and he wanted Q-Ron to have maximum damage because, I mean, credit to him, I think most players in Tom's position would have just blown their load, right? Like, I think a typical player, if you're in Tom's spot, you know, I had the visage to lock down Luke, and then he pulled the lightsaber off of Luke to pull the token off so he can still strike. So he could have reattached the lightsaber. Like, he had the mana for it to kill him, and he didn't want to. And most players would have done that, but he didn't. So, and the reason was, he knew if I strike back and he protects out of Q-Ron, he's going to kill me next, like, that same turn, because Q-Ron doing the redirect damage gave him just enough ammunition with the Force Rejuvenation in his hand to be able to blow up all of my objectives. So what I did in the moment was I could have used I could have used Inquisitor's ability, draw the top card of my deck, which I know was a TK strike, and then just tried to TK strike one of his guys. As opposed to striking, right? Because I could have struck, right? Like I could have chosen to TK strike instead of actually striking as a way to prevent the two damage. But I was looking at the board and I just thought, even if I say TK strike with my guy to Luke, I'm not in a great spot. Like he's still too far ahead. He's still gonna kill my board, and I'm gonna be like two damage away from losing in all likelihood. So what I opted to do instead was said, you know what? I remember I told Tom, like, I gotta get desperate here. So I decided to strike to get my tactics off. I ate the two damage and just said, I don't know what this top card of the deck is, but I gotta hope that it's like the big card. And I top decked the best card you could get. I top decked Arnon Lynn, targeted Luke. Q-Ron had already burned all of his protect, and then with the choke I had in hand was enough to just kill everything he had. And then from there I was able to coast, right? But that was an incredibly lucky situation. But the moral of the story here isn't that I got lucky, right? It's not that even that Given Your Anger is a particularly amazing card. It's just that gave myself a chance to get lucky, right? Like, that's a game that I think I lose 90% of the time, 95% of the time. Like, a player that's as good as Tom and draws as well as Tom did in that game, you're just not going to win, right? Unless you draw close to perfectly, you have no hope. And so, like, even in Tom's case, like I mentioned, he chose not to blow his load with the Luke strike because let's assume he would have blown his load, right? Let's assume he would have attached the lightsaber, put it on Luke, then I probably draw the card, right? Then I probably just draw the card and try to TK strike, and I don't do the same move of the Given Your Anger, but he would not get the redirect damage with Q-Ron, right? He wouldn't get the two free damage with Q-Ron, and he wouldn't be able to attack with Q-Ron. So it would have prevented him from winning the game if he did that. So he was smart enough to not do that. It just ended up backfiring on him in like the worst possible way, because how was he supposed to know that the second card down on my deck was Arnon Lynn and I was going to roll the dice and pray that I got her? Like, he can't know that stuff. And that's unfortunate. But sometimes you need that kind of luck to win. And on light side, a similar example I can think of is I was up against John Hurth Clark in the second round of Swiss. And with my deck, the only card I'm legitimately afraid of from Dark Side, actually, there's two cards I'm afraid of. One is Duel. And the reason I don't like Duel is that Duel messes with how fast you can blow up objectives. And so in a deck like mine, where I'm playing guys during conflict and there's a lot of deception and I try to pull off big combos, it really messes with you when after you blow up the first objective, he can immediately free up one of his blockers. Because I generally try to like lock out your whole board first and then rip off combos. So if you can surprise create a blocker, it really changes the battle math, especially because I can't double lock every one of your blockers, and Duel can also stop one of my new attackers. So that's a problem. And the bigger problem is a Zagirian Slaver. So somehow this dude has a deck that has both of those cards, and he draws Duel turn one. So he leads off with like a turn one Duel plus either a Galactic Scum or a what's it called, or a Spider. It's one of those, and then he just kept crapping out dudes. So in that matchup, that's again, like, he's a really good player, and when you're up against a good player, in this case, so like, he was drawing well, but more importantly, he just had a really good matchup for my deck. So in this situation, I just thought, again, you gotta get lucky. You need some high variance. So the card that kind of bailed me out here was Bamboozle. Now, Bamboozle is just a universally good card. The card that really saved me was Undercover. So Undercover is one of those cards that I generally, like 90% of the time, am just using for edge cards. So similar to I Don't Like You, or sorry, Given Your Anger. So Given Your Anger, it's mostly Nudge Killer. That's really what that card's in the deck for. It's just to get rid of nudges. So it's going to do what I need it to do almost every time. Similarly, Undercover, most of the time what I'm doing with Undercover is I'm shuffling Yodas back in the deck, I'm shuffling Three Pippers back in the deck, I'm shuffling Twist back in the deck, and I'm shuffling relevant units back in the deck. So it's always good, right? It just increases the consistency of your deck by giving you good cards that you need to draw, because it doesn't really matter whether I draw Lando or Yoda. It just matters that I draw one of them. And if I just keep shuffling the dead ones back in the deck, it makes it so I draw hands that consistently have units. And also consistently have high pip edge cards so I can later on in the game just dominate edge battles. So most of the time, that's what that card is there for. It's just there to increase the consistency of your deck. But every now and again, you're going to be in a spot like I was against John where you know your host. Like, you know turn one, you're probably going to lose barring some miracle. And so what I did in that game was I just shuffled Bamboozles back in the deck. Like, my thought was, against his deck, luckily there's not a whole lot of elite. So the only way I can realistically win here is he had the Hunters. So that was good. So he had the Hunters as one of his opening objectives. So I was thinking, if I can stack my attacks correctly and I can blow up all three of his objectives at the same time, that prevents Duel from doing what he does. Furthermore, if I Bamboozle every turn or close to every turn, I can keep his board in check by just tactics everywhere. It's not the greatest plan, right? It's not a plan that's gonna work most of the time, but like, when you're up against that deck, what are you gonna do? So what I did was I just kept shuffling Bamboozles back in the deck. And if you shuffle a Bamboozle back into a deck, so you have two of them in there, if your deck's about 30 cards, you have about a 1 in 3 chance to hit it, assuming that you're max cycling, which I was trying to do. So I believe I played Bamboozle 4 times in that game. Like, I just kept drawing Bamboozles. And that's lucky, right? Like, it's lucky if you can keep drawing the card you need to draw. So it was like, on my turn, it would be Lando attacks, drops a tactics on a dude, Bamboozle for another tactics, drops another tactics on a dude, or Yoda does that, or Kraken does that, and I just kept firing off these Bamboozles. And what he would do on his turn is, like, he's a pretty aggressive player, so he'd like play dudes and then just swing into me, and he was very close to finishing me off. Like, the reason he didn't finish me off was he missed an attack, as far as I remember. So he was like 1 or 2 damage short from winning. So even with the fact that I drew all these bamboozled, he still almost won and still probably should have won. You know, like he's, I mean, again, he's a good player, drew well, and had the right type of deck where the only way I could win is if I got lucky and if I played extraordinarily well, which both those things happen. But this comes back to the moral of high variance, right? So I only have the opportunity to bamboozle them four times in a game and get lucky that way if I have the card that allows me to do that, right? If I have this card that enables me to get lucky, you know, you have to have the chance to actually get lucky in order to get lucky, right? So I think a lot of people, when they build decks, they don't factor that in. They don't factor in, is there any card in here that can bail me out? Is there any card in this deck that shit hits the fan, I'm gonna lose, can I get a miracle here? You know, can I win a game that I have no business winning? And you don't, not every deck needs to bank on that, right? Like, that doesn't need to be your primary win condition. So I wouldn't say that, like, bamboozling 3 to 4 times a game against scum, while it's really good, that shouldn't be plan A. You know, I think if he didn't have the slavers and he didn't have duel and he didn't have the corrupt officials, I wouldn't feel the need to get that desperate. But knowing what he was playing, that's when you need to get desperate. Like, if he was playing like a more traditional scum deck, I probably would have been fine. If he'd been playing force hunters, I probably would have been fine. But that's not what he was playing. He was playing a little more of a different scum deck that was harder for me to deal with. You know, the fact that he can just negate 4 damage all at once by pitching a corrupt official, that's a really big deal. That's something that makes it incredibly hard for my deck to deal with. Then you throw in, you got Dengar's objective where he's preventing damage. It's all bad. It's really hard to play against that deck, and I got lucky. But I did put myself in a situation to get lucky, and that's the key. You know, just giving yourself that chance to get lucky is a lot more valuable than I think a lot of people give credit for. And I think a big reason for that is I think a lot of people, they look at a card that's a little bit more high variance, and then they think, oh, I can't play that because I can't bank on my deck getting lucky. I think this is like the fundamental criticism of Spark decks. Most people, when they look at Spark decks, they say, oh, well, you either hit Spark or you don't, so it's all luck. And you can't think of it that way. You have to think about it in more of a, if I hit Spark, I have the potential to blow this game open, but I can still win without Spark. And if you can figure out a way to make the Spark cards work without the objective being on the table, that's when that deck's able to hit another level. That's why there's one deck that was 25% of the field for Lightside at Worlds, and that's because it was probably the best deck. I mean, I personally think that Owen Jedi decks have the highest upside of any of the decks. I do think Spark decks, you can make a very, very good case that they are the best deck, and the placement that they had in the last big tournament, I think, goes to show that. And we'll see if that continues. We'll see if Darkseid's able to adjust the Spark decks. We'll see if Hera changes how Lightside plays. But having these high variance things and learning how to control it, right? Like learning how to deal with the fact that you're not always going to hit, but knowing how to capitalize when you do hit, I think is oftentimes what separates good players and bad players. So yeah, just some words to think on. This one ran a little bit longer than I probably wanted to. I probably rambled more than I should have. But it's something that I think about a lot and just have been having trouble putting into words exactly what I'm thinking about. So hope you enjoyed this episode. This is Holding All the Cards. See you next time.